Hello, everyone. I'm Usman, Latif, and I'm here to tell you about a bit of the journey of my humanitarian activities in the last few years. Before I start anything, I would like to thank the awesome team at OSM and HOT for inviting me here to share my experience. So basically, I'm a marketing and communication technologist. I'm a journalist and I'm a humanitarian. And my journey started from 2005 earthquake in Pakistan when, you know, in northern areas of Pakistan, they were like, this was one of the most severe earthquakes in last few years. So there was a lot of devastation and everyone was thinking that how they can help Pakistan and the people out there. I guess there were not enough maps then, no planning, no proper tools of data collection. Everyone was clueless like me. So these are the pictures I'm showing you of the devastation it had in the earthquake hit areas. So in 2008, Google actually launched a Google Map Maker tool in Pakistan. When I started playing with the tool, I was one of the first few mappers who started playing with the tool, and I was like really amazed what it could do. And soon enough, we were like creating a lot of maps. There was a community which never met physically, but this is a map of Lahore. You see that when Google launched, it was like this on the left, and in a few months or maybe a year time, Lahore was mapped like this. So that's a lot of data, and what we got to know from Google, like Lahore was the fastest map city in Google Map Maker, communities all over the world, and there are other stats there were other stats like Islamabad was the cleanest map, and you know, we did a lot of work there. So in 2010, for the very first time, we had a Lahore mapping party organized by Google in Pakistan. Google is not in Pakistan, but the Google representative actually organized a party for the mapping community so that they could actually meet and discuss about the issues around the mapping and how it can help or what are the concerns people have. So most of the mappers met for the very first time that day, and I was one of them. Unfortunately, the same month, there was like a landslide in the northern areas of Hunza Valley in Pakistan, which actually blocked a whole river in that area. So if you can see the picture, there's a landslide which actually blocked the whole river. It was winter season, so water was not there. But whatever it was, like it submerged the bridge it had, disconnecting the two sides of the mountains. And soon enough, in June, when the ice started melting, you can see the same imagery which was taken by NASA. Landslide is still there, but you see the red areas. These are basically the communities that were affected by the rising level of waters. There were millions of people migrating to new areas. 20 people actually died due to the landslides. There were like two villages there, but the real problem started after the ice started melting, and the dates are basically the levels of water when it reached there. So the main point is that we, the mapping community, were the first one to actually point out that this happened. 3 months later, anyone started taking notice when the water started rising, and then it became a real big issue. But soon enough, there was another issue for Pakistan. If you remember the 2010 floods in Pakistan, which were like the worst in last several years, almost 30-40% of Pakistan was underwater. People were floating over their own houses. So these are some pictures from there. And we were, and then the mapping community in Pakistan was very active. We were calling for support, for imagery, for translation, for data sets from anywhere. So you can see the chaos people were in. So it was very, very horrific. So this is Army helicopter providing rations, and this is Army helicopter. Like, Army was one of the major, I guess one of the only, I believe, who had the capacity to do a rescue at a massive scale. And the interesting thing is that actually once they were done in November 2010, they actually released a press release which actually appreciated the data from Google Map Maker. It's still available online. There is a link. I'm not sure where's the link. Okay. I'll give you the link. But this is a press release available online. So they actually complimented the efforts of that Google Map Maker provided to them. And, you know, ultimately, they are actually appreciating the work that was done by the mapping community in Pakistan. So we were really proud. Since I was part of it, we started to become a bigger community. Google realized this, and for the very first time, I went to the Google Geo User Summit in Singapore, which was like a regional conference for Google mapping communities all over the Asia. Google used to have different communities, so I'm sitting right there. Okay, just in case if you don't believe me. Okay, so soon enough, so we were very few people. Like, there were hardly some over 100 people, mappers who were very, who were mapping Pakistan at that time. And out of those 100, like, there were very few who were actually mapping a lot. So there were like top 10, 20 mappers. But I started picking up. I became the regional expert reviewer. Then I became the advocate for Google Mapmaker community in Pakistan, which was the highest post then. We kept on meeting. Google was like very, the Google community was very active. This was a Middle East conference, and there was other conferences, but when we were at Google conference in June 2012, something else happened in Pakistan, which was like, there was a law introduced, there was a bill introduced which was proposed by a survey of Pakistan, which reports to the Ministry of Defense in Pakistan, which they wanted to regulate the mapping activities in Pakistan. So I'll give you a minute to actually read this, which are the actual clauses from the law itself. There's a link, you can actually visit that. So it states that mapping and surveying of Pakistan is the sole responsibility of Survey of Pakistan, and no unauthorized geospatial data collection, production, or analysis work can be done by anyone else. These were the. This is, I guess, the crux of it, but there's a lot of other clauses. If you want to really go into this, you need to read the whole document. So then these are the penalties if you don't actually if you violate this law, the Survey of Pakistan can actually launch a criminal case against you. Anyone, any individual or any any organization who violates this, and then there is a penalty of 1 year and up to 1 million rupees if you are violating this law. This was actually it became. So the main point there is that no one actually bothered to talk about the issues it has. There was some press coverage, some bloggers raised the voice, but it did not pick up. It ultimately died. And in 2014, it became a law with the name Surveying and Mapping Act 2014. After this law, so we had to, we stopped mapping. Like, a lot of mappers were confused what's going to happen, what is the outcome of this. So so unauthorized mapping was banned, but there's a clause that says that you can actually get registered to map, but it's not clear who can get registered, because individual mappers, in case of in the context of crowd mapping, who's supposed to get registered? Whether a mapper is supposed to get registered, or the organization who's hosting the maps is going to get registered. So it was not very clear. So, but ultimately they talked about the geospatial data, which includes mapping, cartography, and everything. So, due to the broad nature of the law and confusion around it, mapping was stopped. It came to a halt, and the mappers I knew, including me, stopped mapping Pakistan just in case it was against the law. Then unfortunate event happened in Nepal when it was hit by two earthquakes. So this is a picture from the devastation it had, and you know, map give from the State Department through US Consulate Lahore approached me, and they wanted to know how we can actually help them. So I suggested to them that we can do a mapathon for Nepal to help the on-ground activities there. So this was like approved, and we did a mapathon in June 2015 in the university, which is run by the government and supported by US Consulate and MapGive. So I was the trainer. This is kind of the class. There were like 40 people there who mapped the areas in Nepal. And we took Benson from MapGive online to discuss about how how MapGive is trying to change the crowd mapping and what is MapGive. These are the students who mapped, like in 90 minutes, who mapped like over 3,000-4,000 objects in earthquake areas in Nepal. The guy at the top is basically a professor. He lent us his class so that we could take his class and do this in his university. We distributed swag from MapGive and US Consulate. We distributed certificates so that it actually becomes something valuable to the students. So it's just not an activity that they might wonder what is in it for us. So then I thought, this could be a real opportunity to actually revive the mapping community in Pakistan. Until we are not allowed to map Pakistan, let's map the rest of the world. So that's how Digital Humanitarians, was born. And I kept on, I improved this idea, and then I worked with other organizations. This was US Embassy. They have a scholarship program under which they send from each country, they send some scholars for the US visit. They call it as Pakistan US alumni. So PAN is basically Pakistan US alumni network, which is basically a network of all the scholars who have been to US and they are back in Pakistan. So they wanted them to do something constructive. So we had a mapathon there. These were like 12 people from different regions of Pakistan, from all corners. That was the most interesting part, because they were from people from students from Balochistan, from northern areas, from everything. So it was like a very diverse community. And in 90 minutes, usually my sessions are like for 2 hours. 30 minutes I train them, and then in 90 minutes I actually ask them to do the real practice. So all this practice is done on the map hot activation. So this was the PON result in. Like 90 minutes we did this. They were supposed to provide a presentation on that, so we, in one day, we did the mapathon, and we created a presentation, and we actually presented it. From there on, I collaborated with OSM on we organized some mapathons for the to celebrate the Geography Awareness Week in Pakistan. I talked to the universities. There were like four universities who got on board to discuss and to do this in their campuses. MapGive was again the partner who actually provided support for this. And these are the pictures from the mapathon itself. They are like four different universities. We did four mapathons in 2 days. So these are the actual activities they're doing in different universities. And one of the mapathons, we took Mapbox team online. I'm not sure if Mapbox is here. So Manning from Mapbox actually collaborated on this, and we mapped our tasking manager together. They were working in India, and we were working in Pakistan. So this was just a hello from their side, and this is the awesome community in Pakistan who are working here. And then there was a, this is one of the women-only university in Pakistan. They are all students from geography, and the principal was kind enough to let us train them. She is the principal of the university. She was a coordinator, and we actually held the first ever women-only mapathon in Pakistan. So, okay, so all these mapathon activities were actually done on hot activation. So so the idea was the same. If we cannot help our own people, we cannot map Pakistan because of the legal reasons. Rest of the world still is human, and humanity doesn't end in your borders. So let's see beyond borders. So that was the whole idea, and so we did all the mapping on the hot activations. So one of the questions I was asking to myself was, when we were with Google, it was like mapping for them, and Google is a corporate entity. The data is, you know, is their data. We knew this all along, and we were fine because we had something to use for, and it was a consumer product, and they are still doing a great job. But I wanted to see how we can actually make it sustainable for us. So I looking into other directions, and COP was happening in France, so we partnered with OpenIDO in Pakistan. So I organized a COP is here, Lahore, to discuss the climate change issues. College for Earth and Environmental Sciences in Punjab University actually let us have their class, and we talked about the climate change. This was not a mapathon, but we discussed how mapping or how plotting data can actually help in climate as well. So this was like, there were like 110 people, 10 students in this conference, and so I guess this is the latest I've been doing, and I wish to continue this I wish to continue this motto that we should work for the humanity, and it needs to be beyond borders. If we cannot help Pakistan, let's help other countries until Pakistan is ready to ask for our help. So one of the questions I'm asked again and again, that what is in it for us? With Google Map Maker, it was easy to sell it in a way that we used to tell them, okay, this is not for anyone else, this is for you. You are just not the data producer, basically you are the data consumer as well, because the data you add on Google Maps is going to come back to you when you are going to generate directions. But since we are not mapping Pakistan, we were not mapping Pakistan anymore, I wanted to give it another dimension, which was like it is still a scale. There are a lot of universities with a lot of geography departments and GIS experts in Pakistan who still need the scale, and they might end up working with for an organization who are probably authorized by the government. So what I'm looking for is that we can still do capacity building, skill development, economic development, and everything that comes with getting this scale. The reason I wanted to be here is that I wanted to have partnerships, some direction, some mentoring from the experts in humanitarian mapping. I guess this is the best platform for me. So I would request you to please come to me and let me know if you can help Pakistan in any way. So thank you.
Thank you very much for filling us in on the situation. Are there any questions from the audience?
Thanks for your talk. What's the state of the map in Pakistan now, since you're not allowed to map anymore? Are there people from abroad doing the same you are doing for Nepal, but they do it for Pakistan? Are you aware of any of this?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. So you are talking about what is the current state of maps in Pakistan?
Yeah, of the OpenStreetMap in Pakistan.
So, see, we are not producing maps for Pakistan anymore. There are organizations who are authorized by the government, so mapping is not banned. Just I want to clear this point again. Mapping is still allowed. You have to get approved by the government first to do that. So crowd mapping, because we are individuals, we are not doing that. I'm not doing that. I don't advocate that. So I just, whenever I do a mapathon, I clear this point first that this is not allowed in Pakistan. So if you are working for an organization, then I guess if they are approved, you can do that, but don't try this at home. So I hope I answered your question. Okay.
Yep.
I'm not sure if here is Laura Barroso from Cuba, but I found some similarity with what's happening in Cuba. All the cartography is just reserved for military purposes, so nobody can map over there. So what people did in Cuba is attach a GPS to a dog and go with the dog for a walk and keep doing trackings from old Havana. So that's how they started the map over there. So it was an amazing story. I think there's even a TED talk around. So anyway, I also was wondering if people from Pakistan who lives abroad is mapping their country now that they are in UK, in US, in some other places?
Okay, I guess the speaker is way beyond. Let me come to you to understand your question. Can you please repeat?
Yeah, if people who is from Pakistan and is abroad is mapping Pakistan?
So I'm not sure. See, I guess the law, I'm not an expert on law. So I'm not sure if they are mapping or not first. And I'm not sure if they should be penalized or they can be penalized for this or not, because this is something very typical, and I don't want to, you know, focus on the things that I cannot control. I would like to focus on the things that I can actually control. So I can still build a community. If anyone wants to map it, they can map it. The problem is there's a law which needs to be told. And if government wants to charge you for that, I don't know, they can. So basically, the law applies to Pakistan and for the Pakistani boundaries and to Pakistanis only. So I guess it's if you are outside, you can still do it, because Google Maps is accessible, OpenStreetMaps is accessible, other mapping portals are accessible. People are doing that probably, I'm not sure. But in Pakistan, being a Pakistani, I guess it's still a problem.
We have time for one more question.
Hey, I was just wondering, you mentioned you were using Google Map Makers and then kind of transitioning to OpenStreetMap. And I know in Asia, there is quite a lot of a big Google Map Maker community. And I was wondering how this process was, like how did you convince people, or was it easy or not, or like how did that process happen? And is everyone now mapping with OSM rather than with Google Map Maker?
So when we were working on Google Map Maker, there was a community of very aggressive mappers who did all the mapping in Pakistan. So just to make a point that maps in Pakistan on Google Maps are just manual maps. There's no automated map data from any source. I'm not motivating anyone to move away from what they're doing. To be very frank, they know there's OpenStreetMap, they know there's Google Maps. I used to do mapping on Google, but I believe, because since I've been working with OpenStreetMap, now I understand the power of open data and how it's accessible to everyone, not just me. Not so this is the point. I think I'll be spending more time on open data, which is more accessible, because Google does not allow you to download data. I'm not saying that I would still probably map someday something if I'm allowed, but I guess for far-reaching measures, if you want to think as a long-term plan, you need to map for open map streets, because that is how you can help yourself and others around you. So I'm not motivating anyone. I guess they know better. I'm just teaching new people, and I'm telling them the difference between open mapping and, you know, mapping on other corporate for corporate organizations. Okay.
Thank you for the update. Please give our speaker a warm applause.
Thank you.